welcome to Half the Brain, the podcast that has half the brain you do and half the facts you do. It's your boy, Evil Baz, Big Tasty. Sorry, not Big Tasty. He's not here today. Big Evil, Big Dirty. Joined once as ever by my tag team partner, Mr. Ferry Tunk. Niall, how we doing? Love you, all right?
Hit my music. I'm good, thank you. How are you?
I'm very good. You've been watching anything recently? Have you been up? Have you been keeping up with anything recently? Or has the train of the Paul Levesque era run its steam now with you?
I've not been keeping up with much. I've had one eye off the old business for a while with the stress of moving and all that. But I'm very invested in this whole Bloodline versus Randy Orton and Kevin Owens thing now. It's like, are they going to be a lasting concern, or is it just Triple H going, do you know what, you two can have a go?
Flavor of the month, it's back last time. No one gives a shit about this time of the year. It's like December. No one really cares about wrestling in December. We've just had WrestleMania. We've just had a big tea, and now we just want a bit of a sleep on the settee before SummerSlam, or maybe King of the Ring. I don't know. Maybe. We'll see. Joining us this month is your boy, Mr. Summertime, Mr. Martin Big Battelle. How we doing? Love you, all right?
Yeah, good. It's actually sunny for once, isn't it, as well?
It is quite sunny.
Pointless to get on a podcast, but do you like my gimmick hat?
Nice.
It's sat on so much.
I like it. A strawish hat for all the people in podcast land. Right. So this month we're talking WWE / wrestling propaganda. But before we get there, as always, we're gonna play the game of who he wrestled for. And Mr. Martin Big Battelle, Summertime himself, is gonna tell us who we're having this month. So go on, lad, who are we having this month?
The secret wrestling Wikipedia. Yeah. About secret wrestling careers that aren't common knowledge, and I don't know if you realise this is a Hall of Famer. This is in the entertainment industry,
right?
I'm going to tell you about the wrestling career of Mr. Bruce Forsyth.
Oh, right, okay.
It's a big one. This, yeah. He's got it all, hasn't he? Promos, catchphrases. They say that he's the rock of. He's like the rock of light entertainment, isn't he?
With his catchphrases and promos, definitely. Yeah, yeah.
And his poses. Don't forget his poses.
His poses as well.
Poses. Womanizing. he's like that, you know, in the territory days, like.
Allegations have been beaten.
So I don't know if you know.
The Rock had a bit.
I'll get to that. But one thing I have to say before I get on with this, and it's hard work when you're talking about old celebrities, but Bruce Forsyth isn't a pedo.
Exactly.
I'll just say that there, which is a rarity. He's actually a bit too old for that pedo generation of presenters. He's a bit older than them all. I don't even know this. He started wrestling like very many British wrestlers did. I've actually got the date of his first appearance. It was 1947. He debuted at a circus under a mask. And he, because of his face and his... At the circus.
Right, okay. Wrestling at the circus. Yeah.
Under a mask. We'll come and wrestle the guy. Well, obviously the shape of his face, he became pretty well known. He was known as the Masked Banana.
Right, okay.
Obviously because of the shape of his face. So he was doing that. He got called up to the Air Force in 1949. He did his 2 years. And then he came back, he got rid of the mask, and his new gimmick, this is in Britain, this is Captain Brucey.
Captain Brucey.
Where he played. It's not much of a gimmick, just he's not at his form yet. He's just like any sort of army wrestling gimmick, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Bit of camo, bit of an hat.
Them two in WCW fought each other, no one give a fuck. Captain, there were two captains or something.
Craig Pittman.
The army gear.
Was Pittman
Cobra or something like that?
Oh, Cobra.
Yeah, that's him.
Craig Pittman Cobra. Yeah, when he did the fucking Cobra walk across the ring, like on his shoulders, like fucking hell.
He had a 4 month feud that ended in a 2 minute match, didn't he?
Yeah. Yeah,
anyway, Captain Brucey, he was still wrestling. He was quite well known on the British scene as Captain Brucey. Obviously, he was getting pretty famous with his entertaining. He's the other side of the business, which at that time, if he was about now, how much would they love him? You know, the cross branding with his tap dancing and he's all over entertainment. The wrestling in Britain then, they didn't like it yet. You're dealing with like a young Marty Jones and people like that.
Yeah.
He actually got blacklisted from World of Sport in 1974 due to an altercation outside the London Palladium where he assaulted Shirley Crabtree. Shirley Crabtree, being a Yorkshireman, was refusing to pay, obviously, just to go and see one of Bruce's variety shows.
Yeah.
And Bruce was having none of it, so he basically twatted Shirley Crabtree. That was him. The Crabtrees ran wrestling, didn't he?
Well, yeah.
So he into his wrestling. By now, he's a household name. He went to Mexico in 1977, where he again donned the mask, and he was known as El Platano, which I don't know if you know what that is.
No, but it's, I'm not familiar banana, with that particular translation.
The banana, his full name was El Bigoto de Cara de Platano, Inglés Emascarado, which means the man with the face like a banana. For short, when he was a heel, he was known as Pene de Platano, which means it means banana penis. That's what the fans. So he wrestled under a mask in Mexico. He obviously, it was a flying visit. It was like when Tony Khan gets them masked Mexican lads in.
Yeah.
Very much similar. A couple of matches here and there. He actually, his final match was actually in 2007, where he had a. Do you know that you're familiar with Conan, the farting commentator and ex wrestler? Well, if you notice, from 2007, he no longer had dreadlocks, did he? Well, that is because he was defeated by Pene de Platano in a mask versus hair match, and Bruce Forsyth shaved Conan's head.
Yeah, I remember that classic, absolute classic of a match.
Got that on video.
He didn't do much wrestling then, but I did find out that towards the end of his career on Strictly, he got in a bit of trouble. I think this is when they were phasing him out. He was losing his mind a bit, but he did put Test Daly in a full Nelson, and Anton Dubek had to split it up, and then he was never seen on the screens again. They just sort of shoved him away, and I think he went to a home, didn't he?
Test Daly's the commissioner of Strictly Come Dancing, so you can't really put your hands on authority figures like that. So,
but yeah, as you can imagine, his promos were fucking brilliant. His entrances were something else.
Amazing. Yeah, you see. So we're saying he was in World of Sport to mid 70s.
Yeah.
He got blacklisted from World of Sport, went over to Mexico and did
World of Sport, he was British. He was just British wrestling. He didn't wrestle on television.
Right, yeah. He did a bit
on television, but he got blacklisted for World of Sport due to the altercation with Crabtree outside of the Palladium.
London Palladium, yeah. But he sort of worked the indies worldwide after that. So, right, yeah.
He couldn't wrestle in Britain as well because of the shape of his face. You could see it under the mask.
Yeah. You knew who he was. Everyone knows. Bruce Forsyth, ladies and gentlemen, goes into the Hall of Fame on the Who He Wrestled For Half the Brain podcast. Excellent work on that, mate. Well done.
Imagine how many different catchphrases he had, you know, with his entrance. Like he went through the scene of nice to see you, to see you.
Nice.
Good game is when he was a heel. He's during a match.
I think, you know, when Rey Mysterio comes out and he puts his head next to a kid who's got his mask on, Bruce Forsyth did that. He'd go up to a little kid who had the mask on and he'd go, good game, good game. And then he'd get in the ring and, like, you know, but he'd say that to the kids. Then the
kid, you're going
to
say he'd put his chin on their chin.
Yeah, chin to chin, sorry, with his mask.
He doesn't need to leave the fucking ring for that, does he?
Oh, him and Jimmy Hill as a tag team together would be a dangerous force.
They made this joke once, genuinely, on a show. They said it's they put the chins together and went, oh, it's London Bridge. That's what Goosey made the joke. Obviously, Jimmy Hill weren't really a joker, were he? He was just a madman.
He's just a bit mad. Turned up pissed once on Match of the Day. Absolutely. Oh, he's running. Okay, brilliant. Right. Enough of this madness. Let's get to some WWE propaganda. Now, I want to preface first, before we start, that kayfabe isn't propaganda. So, you know, Colonel Mustafa, Colonel Mustafa being, you know, from Iraq and part of Saddam Hussein's cabal isn't, you know, propaganda. That's just kayfabe. You know, the Ultimate Warrior being from parts unknown, that's not propaganda, that's kayfabe, that kind of shit.
I need to realize, well, the difference between propaganda and conspiracy theories. When you say Ultimate Warrior, then I'm just putting a big cross out here because you know what I'm going to be.
Oh, don't worry, we'll get to him. But also,
I think it comes up every time I'm on the podcast.
So what we're talking about is stuff like DX invading WCW
with a tank.
When they were actually on a Jeep with a bit of tubing on the back. You know, that kind of... No one ever remembers the promo the next week where Triple H stole a jet and wrote WCW sucks in skywriting. No one ever talks about that. They never bring that one up. But they're always bringing up...
Was it a golf buggy? It weren't a tank, were it?
No, it was a Jeep. It was a Jeep with a bit of tubing on the back that made it look like a sort of a rifle or whatever, or a cannon or something, if you will.
They don't half milk that's it. Oh, it weren't even that gun. It was rubbish, wasn't it?
That's one of my notes on here. DX attacked WCW in a tank. Bullshit. Also, Triple H wasn't as important as he wants to make out he was in the Attitude Era. He was like the sixth...
In DX, he weren't. He was like a golfer, wasn't he?
Well, pretty much like... When it started, he was, and then he brought in X-Pac, and I thought X-Pac sort of took the lead role of the lead guy in DX a little bit at that point. I don't know, but the New Age Outlaws were way more popular than he ever was. China was way more popular than he was. During the Attitude Era, you had like what, Austin, Rock, Undertaker, Mankind, Kane. Those five guys had come before Triple H. And even if you went to WCW, you've still got Nash, Hall, Hogan, Sting, Lex Luger, you know, before you get to Bret Hart at that point as well, before you even get to Triple H. Like. Right, so yeah, WWE propaganda. Let's, and like I say, we're not talking kayfabe, we're talking propaganda. So kayfabe would be something like... The Ultimate Warrior comes from parts unknown, or Colonel Mustafa is part of Saddam Hussein's hurry. Whereas propaganda is a DX invading WCW in a tank. It didn't happen in a tank. They were in a Jeep with a little bit of tubing on the back.
Attendances?
Sorry?
Attendances?
Yeah. Attendances could be propaganda, yeah, because, you know, that's... anything that I think is... is bullshit, bullshit, you know, rather than kayfabe, which isn't really bullshit. It's more sort of like adding into the story, and it's part of the story. So I think that's where the difference sort of lies. Niall, do you want to start with one? Do you want to start us off somewhere and we'll get rambling?
I think mine was mostly kayfabe, to be honest. One thing I have thought of, though... Hmm? Is the constant WWE narrative that WCW went out of business. They didn't.
Oh yeah, they didn't. I don't think they didn't stop training until like 2017 or something like that, or 2007, something like that.
Yeah, and like they didn't go out of business because WWE bought them.
Well, technically they didn't. So what WWE did was buy the library and a couple of people's contracts, and that's why they let. That's why WCW as a company survived till 2007 because Time Warner still had people like Kevin Nash under contract and Goldberg under contract. So they had to have a sort of like entity to be able to, you know, run as a company and pay those guys. So WWE didn't technically buy WCW. They just bought the rights to the TV library and the name and that kind of thing.
Do you know the point when I knew that WWF, or was it F or E at the time? It was F, wasn't it?
F, yeah.
When they were going to botch the invasion angle and everything, is one WrestleMania when we knew they'd done it, it panned to the crowd and it showed a lot of jobbers and it just said, and they didn't say any of the names, it just said WCW wrestlers.
Yeah. Sean Stasiak and a couple of others, like just nobody, just in the crowd at WrestleMania 18, I think that is it? Is it 18? Yeah, that one. But WCW killed, but also WCW tried to kill WWF in the mid-90s as well. Don't forget, you know, Hogan took all his mates there in the mid-90s and early 90s, and you know, billionaire Ted was, the WWE were just a mom and pop star. They were just a small company trying to do their best. But
Bruce's Beefcake got a main event, didn't he, at Starcade?
Exactly, because he was best mates with Hulk Hogan, so he could do that.
What would that be the equivalent to that be now? Would it be sort of like Aaron Solo getting a main event at a Revolution or something like that?
Oh, I think
Cody's mates with some jobbers, isn't it? It's like him getting fucking.
We saw Brandy at WrestleMania. I think that was a kind of almost like that, wasn't it? Like, you know, we don't see her on telly, and she just got pulled out in the main event of WrestleMania.
Or Jack Perry getting put into the main event in AEW.
Oh, if Jay was here now.
I'm hiding from him at the minute.
But yeah, I think that whole narrative about WCW dying and trying to kill WWF at one point.
Yeah, that entire the DVD I had or borrowed, I think, like the death of WCW. I wanted it because I like WCW. Yeah. And it was just a hatchet job.
The Monday Night War.
That's the one, yeah. It's so one-sided, that, isn't it?
Oh, God, yeah. Yeah, because obviously the
winner... You don't even show any of the good WCW moments.
No, it's all WWF. And if you look there on the back, there they are in the little...
Oh, yeah.
It's not even like one of the best moments of the Attitude Era. It's a memorable moment, like, but...
Yeah, I tell you what, they don't bring up DX because this was more famous than that. They don't bring up DX taking off Mark Henry, do they?
Oh, no. That
was 20 times more popular a segment. And they've only just stopped showing that off.
Definitely. In the last few years, they've only just stopped showing that because Mark Henry doesn't work for him anymore. So they can't wheel Mark Henry out and say, oh, no, that was all right.
Titus has that job now, doesn't he? Is the,
exactly. If someone blacks up as R-Truth or Titus, like, they can wheel him out and it'll be fine now. But, you know, Mark Henry's not there anymore, so he's not there to defend him.
I think that whole thing probably extends to when Vince bought out all the territories as well, because he would have believed that nobody was watching territorial wrestling. It was all in smoky bingo halls attended by, like, 20 people. Mm-hmm. These are TV deals.
I've got the exact phrase here. Outside the WWF / WWE... it's bingo halls and armories. If you don't wrestle for them, then they've only just started mentioning Japan, and they're loving that at the minute. They're loving mentioning Japan. Just every 5 minutes, it's like, oh, this guy was a New Japan open weight heavyweight champion.
They've only just opened the WWE universe, haven't they? They've only acknowledged that these places exist now, haven't they?
Oh, there's other places in the universe other than us. Oh my God.
other companies do entertainments.
Well, I mean, there's all sorts. I've got it written down here. Well, that sports entertainment.
Kills me, that.
Yeah. The one that's killing me at the minute is PLE. Premium live event. That's like just being spat out by some corporate guys. What are we watching tonight, guys? Oh, we're watching a premium live event. Oh, amazing. Well done, guys.
When Emma watches AEW Collision, we love Nigel McGuinness, both of us, but at first, she'd always get the arse with him because he kept saying like phrases that they use in WWE. I don't notice it because I watch lots of wrestling, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But him saying superstars really wound her up. Because I think it is. They call everyone superstars.
Well, that's it. You're not wrestlers in WWE, you're superstars. And that was Vince's little pet peeve, wanting for a long time.
Brooklyn Brawler a superstar, really?
Well, that, you know, was Mason Ryan a superstar?
I met him at Skegness. he was wrestling as Goliath. He was a gladiator, wasn't he? He was in the same gladiators as what's that dude called in WWE now on Raw, which suit blue suits on.
Oh, posh, yeah, I know what you mean. Nick
Aldis.
Aldis.
Aldi. That's Aldis. How I remember him.
Yeah,
Nick,
yeah.
Aldi.
Nick Aldi.
he was on Gladiators, wasn't he, when they brought it back and it was shit on Sky. And Goliath was Mason Ryan off that.
Okay, apparently
he was terrible.
Mason Ryan is in the circus now.
He's in that dead famous one, isn't he?
Yeah, that Cirque du Soleil. I think he was in that for a bit. Yeah.
Been in films, so he's had a good career, hasn't he, outside the back? He weren't a good wrestler, were he?
Not at all.
He was just like Batista.
Batista and had a decent body like that, were it? Like, he's not a wrestler in the slightest.
Who else wrestled? Who did he wrestle? He wrestled when he was there. He wrestled Dean Allmack, who's quite famous, isn't he?
Dean Allmack,
yeah. He's a British, like, indie legend. He's had a few matches in TNA.
Oh, right, okay.
And the other one is now a trainer in WWE, Brookside, the Scouser.
Oh, Robbie Brookside, yeah.
He was in match with him and proper carried him. And then
he pretty much opened every European tour in the 90s for WWE. Every time I went, like, the first match has been, and some guy versus, you know, like El Matador versus Robbie Brookside, or, you know.
He's like one of them bands, isn't he? Whenever you go somewhere, it's always the same support band opening.
Brian Knobs versus Robbie Brookside as the opening match.
Was it?
Fucking hell. So, yeah, like Sheffield, you know, I remember seeing him. And I remember in the early 2000s going and watching it at Manchester, and he definitely was in a dark match for Raw. And everyone was chanting, "Who are you? Who are you?"
This reminds me of my biggest bugbear, and it's just literally come to me now, of WWE's bullshit. Oh. The fucking where British Bulldog comes from. To make that man, right, knowing where he's from, right, look into a camera and cut a talk for 40 seconds about London being his hometown. Right. Not the best talker anyway, is he? But fuck me.
No. I'm sure I had a training card that said he was from Sheffield at one point. He's from Sheffield, he's from Leeds, Manchester, London. Yeah.
It's like you're saying to Big Tasty, who's is he classed as Cornish?
That's Paul. Yeah, I would say probably, yeah.
Yeah. It's like saying to him, right, go out there, right? And you're wrestling in Newcastle tonight. Tell him you're in your own town. And he'd have to fucking try and be a Geordie. Like, it just won't happen.
Well, they were quite clever.
I want to hear him try a Geordie accent. You might nail it, but...
they were quite clever if stuff was going to be on British TV, that they did mention, like, Goulburn and Wigan and North Manchester, like, that kind of thing.
Leeds, didn't like though. Wigan, did they? It was always Leeds and Manchester. It's never Wigan, ever.
No.
They never mentioned it. Fucking Leeds, man.
I have seen something with Lord Alfred Hayes where he goes to David Boy's school with him. And he's talking
Melbourne County. My mum teaches there.
My mum
teaches there now.
Is there a plaque to him on the wall?
No, it's in the old school, like where he went. It was knocked down and rebuilt, so it's all like a new building and everything. And there's nothing to commemorate him, which is mad.
You need to go and just put some dreadlocks on the wall.
Make I've been to see his grave.
Yeah.
Is that weird, that? I've been to see his grave. It's like literally a two-minute walk from my mum's. So his funeral was the day in the World Cup 2002 when David Beckham scored a penalty against Argentina and they won 1-0.
Yeah. That was his funeral.
And it was like that was his funeral that day, yeah. Because I don't know, I just remember it. I just remember the two things because I did think about riding my bike down, see if there's any wrestlers there. But I thought better of it. Like.
You should go down there and just leave like
this. It just would have been.
Leave a whopper.
The only one who would have been there would have been.
Leave a whopper on the side, yeah. Leave a whopper on his grave when you go.
The only one who would have been there would have been fuming Tommy Billington, who would have been in his wheelchair, like just being a dick. Horrible man. Horrible man.
With a Japanese box.
Never had a nice thing to say about anyone.
Japanese box stood next to him.
It probably actually wouldn't surprise me. He wouldn't have gone to Bulldog's funeral, I don't think, actually, because he was still so bitter about him, wasn't he?
Probably didn't. Yeah, bitter man. Bitter man.
Yeah.
What have I got here? Right, Mania 1 was a huge risk, right? I don't think so, because... It was in your home arena in like quite possibly the hottest period of the wrestling ever. Wasn't Hulk Hogan on Saturday night's main event the night before WrestleMania 1? I think you'll find he was. You had Mr. T, who was quite possibly the biggest fucking TV star in the world at that point, in the main event. You had Muhammad Ali. He packed it out with celebrities. I think the only sort of make or break thing was the Cold Circuit CCTV, but there's a quote by Linda that says she counted out the, you know, the checks for the CCTV and how much it cost and stayed up till they broke even. So I think she was probably up for about an hour counting like that, like by the looks of the ground and stuff.
I found out the other day, Vingy wrestled at Mania Long, didn't he? Doink.
Doink,
Matt Bourne did, didn't he?
Yeah, Matt Bourne versus Steamboat, isn't it?
Yeah.
Thing in like the third or fourth match, but Mania 1, massive risk. Oh, I'll tell you what a risk that was.
What a maneuver,
bro. Also, Mania 8 had to be moved due to that, security reasons.
Bomb threats
against Sergeant Slaughter. Not due to the fact that you booked a 106,000 seater arena and only sold 16,000 tickets a month out of the event. Nothing to do with that.
Yeah. I'll let you into a secret about Manchester Punk Festival. We were meant to be playing the MEN Arena, but we had to play Gorilla instead because Tet beating his Russian involvement and all sorts of threats going on. Like,
I did hear the rumours of that, to be fair, yeah.
He's the drone flying, he's going into trouble again.
Sergeant Slaughter was talking about wrestling in a bulletproof vest. Was Archie wondering about playing in a bulletproof vest?
He put the wrong vest on, wouldn't he?
He put one on and wouldn't question it. But yeah.
What happened with that then? Did they sold? They wanted to sell 80,000 and they sold 15, wasn't it?
Yeah, basically, they booked an arena. They booked to the LA Coliseum, which I think is 106,000 seater. And like 2 or 3 months out, they'd sold 16,000.
What would Dominic achieve, by the way? Who are these? Who's this organization who were going to bomb the wrestling?
It was because they were doing the whole Iraqi sympathizer with Sergeant Slaughter and he'd burnt the American flag on TV, which apparently...
So they were going to bomb 16,000 people to kill... Surely just wait for him outside the arena and do him.
Exactly, you know. Apparently, the burning of the flag on telly, according to Sergeant Slaughter, was Jesse Ventura's idea. Jesse Ventura had left the company about 3 or 4 years
ago. He fit him up, didn't he? Apparently, it was him who told DX to black up. He was there just before that Mania ref, wasn't he? He goes, I've got a great idea what you should do.
Like, hang on, can I do a Jesse Ventura? Let's see if we can all do a Jesse Ventura. McMahon, let me tell you something, McMahon.
Just that.
Double U. You have to say the word double U very strangely. Double U, double UF.
I always remember a piece of his commentary, right? And I've never seen it since I was about eight. And Vader battered Marcus Alexander Bagwell. Fucking battered him. And Vader was on the top rope doing the Vader bomb, and Jesse Ventura went, "Goodbye, rookie. So long, rookie." And it, poof, right on time he landed. It was brilliant.
McMahon. Let me tell you something, Mean Gene. Well, yeah, no, I can't do Jesse Ventura, clearly.
He's absolutely brilliant, Jesse Ventura, isn't it?
He's a madman now. Go on. I mean, he's just full of conspiracy theories now. Like,
no, when you go back, sorry, his commentary back in the day.
Oh, back in the day, he was brilliant. Like, he stuck to the sort of plan, and he hated Hogan.
I'm guessing he later in life he's gone on that COVID road that Ben's right. Martin Atty, and
he kind of has, but he lives in the Bajas.
He's not vaccinated, I bet.
I don't think he was, because he was governor of Minnesota for a bit, wasn't he? And now he lives in like the Bajas of like the Caribbean down there. And I have a compound chilling in the Bajas. You should come down and see it, McMahon. Let me tell you.
Has he said anything about Vince's fucking shame?
Not that I've seen, actually, no. The last sort of videos I saw of him talking were, and it was Hulk Hogan who told Vince McMahon that I wanted to unionize the WWF. it's those sort of videos. Hulk Hogan was the man who stooged me out to Vince McMahon over the WWF.
It's good.
And let me tell you something, McMahon. I mean, Ventura is his own kettle of fish nowadays. Like, he has gone off the sort of deep end, especially after 9/11. That was his sort of big thing. He went big time off the deep end. How does jet fuel melt steel, McMahon?
He's pals with that. Is he pals with that guy who always cuts promos about, he said one of the famous one about frogs being gay.
They're making the frogs gay!
Alex Jones.
No, he's not mates with Alex Jones. No, I think they're very...
He was on Piers Morgan, him, and Hannah, my daughter, showed me this, because Piers Morgan, so he can't make his mind up what side he's on with anything, can he? No. And in this case with Alex Jones, Piers Morgan's the reek one, right? And he's interviewing him, and Alex Jones starts saying about, he's on about guns, and Alex Jones starts saying, if we was wrestling now, what tights would you wear? What tights would you wear? And Piers Morgan isn't a wrestling fan, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
So he thought Alex Jones meant tights like what women wear. So he went, and he said deadpan to him, looking at him, he went, I don't wear tights, Alex.
But no, I think Ventura and Alex Jones are sort of on the very much on the other ends of the spectrum, but right, be very much close together if they ever sort of had a conversation. But yeah, I think two opposite sort of ends.
There's a lot of Vince Russo. If you hear his versions of events,
oh god, yeah.
There's a lot of propaganda with that. Have you heard his recently? I'm saying this because I watched the Kennel from Hell match. And he said like they were attack dogs.
Yeah,
you were trying to say that these were attack dogs, and you watch, just you can tell they're just from Park.
Yeah,
like, good, right, mate. £100, just walk your dog down here, like.
Just put your dog in that cage, will you? And put him in there. He looks a bit rough, that one. It looks like a Rottweiler. Put him in there. After stuff he created the Attitude Era and all that sort of stuff, I don't believe that for a second. I believe he had ideas. He had ideas and he followed them through Vince, and Vince refined his stuff, you know, a lot like we did with Cornette and stuff like that. I think Vince also has, I don't know if this is propaganda or not, but he has a way of pushing people that just aren't wrestlers. You know, like he'll push him down the throat, and then he'll have to sort of pivot later on and realize, oh, push this guy who can't wrestle a bit too far now, and he has to wrestle. And
the manipulation of the crowd cheering, which is a massive thing with WWE, which it makes it unwatchable.
The speed noise.
I first noticed it. It was Rumble night 92 is when I realised it. I cottoned on. It weren't real.
Right? Yeah.
And it was because of the Sid. I watched two videos different. I watched a live one from mate Sky, and the one that came out from the video shop rented like about 8 months later. That he'd had the cheer, he'd have him booing Sid on it, and it was like, whoa, everyone were cheering Sid. I thought Hogan were going to be a baddie.
Yeah, you can watch that on YouTube. The two different versions of the commentary with Monsoon and Enan.
Why would they have a camera set up behind a fake barbershop window? That is the thing. That's what got me when I was little. I went, that's there because they knew we were going to kick him through that. Ah.
Oh shit! Yeah, I didn't even think about that. Bloody hell!
You see, that's one of the things that TNA always did well. Because no, seriously. So you remember when there was a bit in WWE where I think Edge and Christian were backstage and they were doing like some kind of devious plotting.
Yeah.
And then Foley comes in and is like, right, for that, you can be in a match with such and such. And like, how did you know we were doing that? And Foley's like, you've had a cameraman following you around all day. But TNA used to make it out like their camera people were in the bushes.
Oh, like sneaking about for a bit. Yeah, it was when they started like doing the inside thoughts of Jeff Hardy. That was not good. That was not good at all.
I do like that laugh though. It is funny, that laugh, isn't it?
the Willow one.
It's funny that laugh. It's funny him doing it, right? Because he's not funny, is he? He's quite a tragic fella, isn't he?
Oh, have you ever heard his band?
Oh, he's been posting videos lately of him singing songs.
Yeah, so bad.
Oh, yeah, I remember that horrible theme tune he had that he sung himself. Really bad.
Yeah. It's Imagination. I remember him saying that on Raw to his brother Matt, I think, in a promo. He was on.
There's a bit of propaganda. The fucking charismatic enigma. How is he charismatic? apart from... Apart from that,
do you remember when he used to run in from the back there to do like interference and he'd still stop and do his dance before he like carried on?
Yeah, like what are you doing?
Coming to serve his brother.
And it's like the divas used to do that in the mid 2000s. If there was like a running from a diva, they'd do the pose first and then run and then carry on doing the running. You're like, what are you doing? What are you doing, love? What's going on here? Speaking of women. Stephanie McMahon is a helper and supporter of women and a creator of women's wrestling.
Yeah, she invented women's wrestling.
Stephanie McMahon invented women's wrestling. Also, the WWE, the American government coming after Vince is a lot like 9/11.
Oh, definitely.
Jesus.
But yeah, the whole Stephanie Women's Revolution Divas thing. Absolute bollocks.
It come from her getting called out by AJ Lee, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. On the internet. And if we're going to talk about one McMahon, like we may as well talk about the other. This DVD, McMahon, the story of a two-disc collection of Vince McMahon put out by the WWE, is just utter propaganda, this 100%.
It's fictitious, isn't it? It's fictitious.
Oh, yeah, this is just 100% fairy tales. I think the only
it's like double kayfabe, isn't it? In a weird way,
the only real thing about this is Vince's date of birth, and then the rest of it is made up from there. Think of what
point... when he had that injury when he was walking down and his legs went,
yeah.
When they keep going on about that as if it's not funny.
In that, though, there's one. Gerald Briscoe and Ted Turner tried to take us out of business, and I knew Vince McMahon would whoop his ass. He says it a lot. I mean, he spoke like Forrest Gump anyway at the best of times, like Gerald Briscoe. But in that, it is just, you're just like, oh my God.
I think of him now because I know that Vince was sat behind that fucking desk, rubbing himself whilst them two were pulling evening gowns off each other.
Oh God. Him and Pat Patterson. Oh, no.
Vince's kinks, that, I'm telling you.
Probably would have been. Like, it started off as a joke, but I bet Vince...
Like the fact that he was able to control, to get them to both do that.
Yeah. And have enough power over the two of them on TV to... Because that was at the start of his sort of evil bad guy persona, if you will. But yeah, they all... Stephanie started women wrestling. There's loads of him.
Yeah, like it was. So if I'm right with Stephanie, that came about the quality and equal pay and things like that, and equal TV time and stuff.
Yeah.
And Triple H started then pushing Bayley and Sasha, didn't he, and Charlotte on the NXT. So it wasn't even her. She had nothing to do with it. And then when they had that first pay per view, women's pay per view, she come out, didn't she?
Yeah, at the start of it. And I think she came out on a Raw or maybe SmackDown before it as well and was like, right, we're doing this and it's all...
That's like what we were saying before, like the getting Mark Henry to come out. That's what that is. Here's the woman. Here's the WWE woman.
Exactly, yeah. Is the woman, is the black American who will say that blackface is all right. Here's the woman who will say that us not treating women properly is okay.
Yeah.
Nobody looking to Ashley Massaro or anything like that. Yeah, it's just Martha Hart. I've got written down here that she doesn't want to work with the WWE. If you killed my husband and then tried to sue me, I don't think I'd want to work with you either, to be quite honest.
No, yeah.
And having Mark Henry do that thing at the Hall of Fame where he's like...
You say that Martha Hart's all right, like...
Oh, Martha Hart's amazing. She's amazing.
Whenever I've seen interviews with her, she's come across as really nice. But then
the
only thing I've heard of it until recently was WWE's, like, making out that she was... Like, they make out that she's bitter, don't they?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
She won't let Owen be celebrated. Like, fuck off.
And the rest of the Hearts are just as worse because they've all sort of fallen out with her because she won't have anything to do with WWE. And they think, oh, well, if I get her to sort of have something to do with WWE, that'll mean I can get in with them. And they're all just constantly looking for a job at any point, the rest of them. Not Brett. I don't think Brett is, but, I mean, the rest of them are constantly Bruce.
Who's that one with the blonde hair with leather jacket?
Bruce. That's Bruce.
Ridiculous.
Absolutely. What was his look in the 90s in the slightest? What was going on there? Like, but yeah, I just, there were a lot there. Big carnies, them lot, the rest of the house.
Yeah, he was dressed like he was 10 years out of fashion, wasn't he? he dressed like he was in Starsky and Hutch. And like, if you think about it, grunge had kicked off.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
he looked like a bad guy from Airwolf.
Yeah, he did. didn't British Bulldog throw water on him or something like as a joke? They didn't tell him he was in crowd and he got like a bit. Whenever he got a bit, he'd ham it up, wouldn't he, trying to get a job?
Yeah.
Bulldog like pretended to spill a big bucket of water over him, soaked his suit, and it was all like Owen told him to do it, told Davey Boy to do it, set piss out of him, and he was fucking fuming.
Okay, all right, I'm going to go to my third and last DVD that I've got here with me as well. The Self-Destruction of the Ultimate Warrior. I mean, this is more a sort of hatchet job than propaganda, but it sort of, propaganda falls into it, but I don't think it's as bad as it could have been. Mm. They rewrote it and did a new DVD that came out of The Ultimate Warrior, and I can't remember what that one was called, or The Resurrection of the Ultimate Warrior or something like that. I quite like that DVD, though, to be fair. I mean, he is a dick. Let's get that out of the way. He was a knobhead. But I don't think he deserved quite the shit he got in that.
Stick by your convictions as well. Like, don't make another one and say, like, make out it's all good. It's either one or the other, isn't it? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You apologise, say you were wrong, or one thing or the other. Like, it's...
Yeah, you know, like...
Carnies everywhere, aren't they? The Warrior Awards stinks, doesn't it?
It's just...
Stinks.
Yeah.
Have you got rid of that?
They've stopped
one at this year's.
They've stopped televising it.
Have they?
Yeah, they still do it, but they've just stopped televising it.
Here's an award named after a fucking horrible man who wouldn't like he wouldn't do anything to help you, if you know what I mean.
Wrote a comic book where he's raping Santa Claus. That
bizarre. For all his flaws, and by God, does he have many flaws? But Bret Hart said in his autobiography that Hogan like went seeing, you know, like kids and fans and stuff.
Yeah,
and he said that that's the difference between them as champions. Like, Hogan would go to hospital and see kids and stuff like that and be dead good with them, and Warriors wouldn't do that.
No, I just wouldn't do it at all. Apparently, yeah, wouldn't have anything to do with him. But you know, in that DVD, they say, "Oh, his WCW debut was awful," and it wasn't. It was a big ratings draw, to be fair. And WCW beat you that night because of him. You know,
he did draw though. That was the thing. He drew in WWF and WCW.
He sort of did, but then he didn't. It tailed off. He did initially when he beat Honky Tonk Man, and he was Intercontinental Champion. He was drawing on that way up to the championship. When he won the championship and they put him with Rude, he sort of wasn't clicking. He needed someone else, maybe, but Rude had worked with him on the way up, so he knew how to work with him. Like, you know, he could be, you know, be a good worker with him, sort of thing. But I don't think they really put the Monster of the Month like they did with Hogan with him. And if they'd have done that, maybe he could have worked a little bit better. But I think his steam just sort of ran out, like he does.
We missed out on is a match between Giant Haystack and the Ultimate Warrior. Iron Man, Stadium Stampede match.
Yeah, they both have to start off at one end of the stadium each. Fucking hell, they'd be dead by the time they got to the halfway line.
That weasel face hat.
That weasel face hat. I'll get you.
Yes, that's what I refer to him as. They should have given him a live mic.
Oh, fuck it. Just that.
Mic. Start. What? It weren't Nitro then, was it? But start the show. Yeah, it was. It was Nitro, wasn't it?
Yeah,
start Nitro. 20 minute Loch Ness promo. That's what I would have been up to if I was booking it.
Oh, let me tell you something, me Gene.
He says that, doesn't he? Let me tell you something.
Oh yeah. Okay. Everybody who was interviewed by me Gene in the 90s started most of the promos off like that because they didn't know what else to. Once you've got that man in front of you, the only way you can start off is, well, let me tell you something, Mean Gene. unless you're Ric Flair, and then Mean by God Gene.
I wish if Marty Jones was 10 years younger, Vince Russo got hold of him and saw him. Imagine what he'd be playing.
No, it'd be like a Phil LaFonna or a Doug Furness. Marty Jones, if he got caught, like JR would love him, but Russo wouldn't know what to do with him. He'd be one of those guys, like, you know.
JR loves American football college players, doesn't he?
Yeah. This guy's an all-American.
Ron Simmons.
No idea what that is.
I thought Ron Simmons, right, when I watched him when I was a kid, because of JR, yeah. I thought Ron Simmons was like a wrestling football. I thought he was more famous as a footballer.
Yeah.
Come to wrestling. Yeah. And I realised, and he just played like fucking same level as I did rugby league. You know what I mean? You weren't that good. Just play for his school. Just play for his school.
The bit in that promo that always used to get me, the bit that where they were all looking back and I played football at Florida State. They retired my locker at Florida. I'm like, you retired your locker? Right, did he do that? Is that a thing?
I can't remember what British wrestler it was, but because it tied in with football, right? This is very much on topic. Because it tied in with football, they said something like, he had trials for Man United or something like that. And then you watch him and you see his footwork, and you think you can sell a footballer, can't you? Like, no, he doesn't move like any footballer. He's fucking five times the weight of any footballer. He'd at best have a trial for like Ashton Athletic, you know what I mean?
Weren't there a goalkeeper from Germany who had a stint in NXT?
Yes, there were, yeah.
didn't, what about Grant Holt? What happened with Grant Holt?
Oh, that was just a local wrestling thing. That.
Was it? Was he not? Was he not getting into it proper? Like, no.
Oh, but that's like the opposite. He, like, have you seen him move as a footballer? There's no way he's running the ball. He's like that babble we saw during that match. That
barrel, yeah, fucking hell.
He's one of them players who's just, we're getting onto football talk here, but.
Yeah. Anyway. The last one I've got here was that ECW was on the WWF payroll and WWF just took whatever they wanted from it because they were paying them. So if they wanted somebody, they'd just take them. And if they wanted to send somebody there, they sent Al Snow there. They sent Baracus, who we never actually saw wrestle on telly. He was in the Brawl for All, but he never wrestled for WWE. They sent Furnace and LaFon to ECW. There was a lot that went the other way as opposed to WWE just taking what they wanted. But it was their sort of training, their NXT for the mid-90s, ECW, I think. The fact that they say, oh, it wasn't, it was this extreme. It was, you know, they were doing things differently and they had, you know, different ideas and stuff like that. But I don't think that for a second they weren't on the WWE's payroll.
Do you know, I've just thought of one.
Go on.
Haku. Haku's stories about ideas.
Do you think that's bullshit?
Yeah, it's never just like, oh, he knocked it. Because what would happen is he'd be pissed up in a bar and so, and he'll either be a bully and chin someone straight away or someone's giving him some shit and he's knocked him out. But they can't just say that he punched it. It's always like he pulled his eye and it dangled on a socket, then he bit it and ate it, regurgitated back out of the toilet, made him eat it again.
The police, there was 15 police officers and they all sprayed mace in his face.
But he was in the right. A man spilled his drink and he removed his jaw. That's not good. That's not being hard. That's there's someone who needs locking up. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah. The fucking, the
camera. You see him in ring as well. He's just a big docile dope as well. He was rubbish. Rubbish. No charisma.
Just for the record, this is Martin Battle saying all these things. if any of this turns out to be true,
I'll have him.
I'll have him. Don't scare me. I think there's a bit of that. Like, I don't believe Undertaker's as hard as he makes out to me. You know,
I can't. You can't sit so. You don't have a reputation like that without being a monster, do you? But Undertaker. No,
but he is, don't forget, he's like 6 foot.
It's rubbish, isn't it? It's just because he wrestled for the longest.
Yeah, and he's massive. He's like 6 foot 10, 6 foot 11, something like that. You know, you're not winning it in a fight easy with him. But, you know, Joey Styles knocked out JBL with one punch. So, you know, David versus Goliath, etc. Like, but. Yeah.
That was ace seeing that, wasn't it?
Can you imagine walking backstage? You're a new wrestler, right? In the mid-90s. You're walking backstage into the WWE locker room and someone goes, oh, over there, that's the Bone Street crew. And they point to Undertaker, Yoko Zuna, Karma Mustafa, the Godwins,
fucking hell,
and Savio Vega. And go,
it's just, that's just the John Bull in Wigan.
Yeah. Just his bike. The fat lads in the corner, are they? The Domino's crew. No, no.
I've been jukebox playing Led Zeppelin over and over and over and over.
You know, I've been watching WCW again this week, the start of the NWO, and I was thinking to myself, I wonder why these were so popular. And then I put WWE on for 1995, like Raw. Just try and watch a full episode of that shit. Oh my God. Fucking hell. But like, yeah. Like the Bone Street crew were, you know, the fucking, oh, that just made
He's
me
full
laugh.
Of it, isn't it? Taker's full of WWE's propaganda.
Oh yeah. Big time.
Like his WrestleMania streak, they don't count that. Did he actually win that match against Giant Gonzalez?
Well, he did because he got Gonzalez got disqualified because gas like on his face. So he got disqualified. So But like until it gets to Mark Henry, I don't think they take it seriously at all in the slightest. They don't even know it's a thing, I don't think, for
yeah, they don't acknowledge it until I think, like you say, it's after Henry, and then they start putting up the streak.
Yeah. But I mean, even then, you know, he's still like two of them are Shawn Michaels, two of them are Triple H, you know, like after that, you got what, Mark Henry, Randy Orton, Triple H, Shawn Michaels, who else after that? Like, you know, Edge as well. Isn't that like, you know, anyway.
Do you know what, when you mentioned that this was the topic?
Yeah.
Do you know what instantly popped into my head when I thought of the words of propaganda? Saudi Arabia. Like, did you watch that very first one?
Yeah.
Like the progressive city of Jeddah, and it was like showing, and it was like, oh God. Oh,
God. Yeah.
And then about 3 months later, that journalist got murdered.
Well, I think it was before that, wasn't it? The first one, it was like a sort of month or two before the first one was supposed to happen.
Well, at the first one, there were no women on it at all, was there?
No.
Because
no.
I remember watching it and like, me, and I'm like, what the hell? Because they had, I can't remember if it was the wrestle, it was an Italian, someone else, and they made them wear all in ones and the T-shirt over top.
Yeah.
And someone threw something at the Italian as well, didn't they?
Yeah. And they had to have like hats on and stuff like that. Burkas, sorry, not hats. That's the word.
Odd shit that's come out of there, though. I'm pretty sure, I can't remember who they'd requested. They wanted like a match with someone, but it turns out this person's been dead for like 10 years.
Yokozuna.
That was it.
Yokozuna, yeah. So they had a man called Babatunde, didn't they?
Babatunde, that's why they booked Babatunde.
Oh, no, Babatunde was an NXT guy, wasn't he? It was an old sumo wrestler, wasn't he? Just
the guy who died recently.
Can't think of his name. He looked nothing like Yokozuna, though.
He wasn't Akebono, was he? They didn't bring him back for that.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
They don't mention that anymore now, do they? Because that was the greatest Royal Rumble, it were called.
Yeah.
Braun Strowman won it, didn't it? But Daniel Bryan was in it for like the longest ever anyone's been in one, wasn't he?
Was he?
He was like the Iron Man, wasn't he? He was in at number three.
Right.
That was the one where your man flung himself under the ring, wasn't it?
Tyus.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
One of the greatest fucking moments in history.
Well, I
remember that well because I was watching that, like, my daughter was a little girl then and she was well into wrestling. And she was pissing aside, laughing at like the no-name wrestlers that were coming out. Because the one that killed her was Tucker Knight, Otis's partner. But we'd not seen him on telly. So just this man called Tucker Knight starts jogging down wearing a yellow beret. We're like, what's he doing? And then there was someone called Dan Mather, who was like about 6 foot 10 and about 12 stone with size 86 feet. And he like moved like L.A. Gonte.
I think we have to start saying that, you know, instead of saying like, oh, they're the Marty Jannetty of this group, we're going to have to start saying they're the Tucker Knight of this group because what has he done since that, like, Otis has gone on to sort of like mega stardom, if you will, and Tucker Knight disappeared. No one's seen, like that wildcat.
Is Otis one of your favourites, Danny?
Who? Always.
Oh, yeah.
He looked, because the man looks like he comes from Oldham.
Yeah, that's all I see. So when I watch Otis now, I watch it not for face value. I watch it as a man from, as if he's a man from Oldham. Yeah. And it makes it loads better.
Did you ever see the bit where he was with Alpha Academy and Gable made him cut his hair and shave?
No.
Yeah.
Man's terrifying. He had a whole relationship angle with Mandy Rose as well. And it was booked to look legit.
Oh, that I remember that with Dolph Ziggler.
Yeah. And it wasn't just like fat man gets with hot chick, let's all laugh. It was like proper.
Oh, no, yeah, because the crowd got into that. So that's the moment where they pivoted. They've seen what they've gone. What we'll do here is we'll take Otis down and, you know, we'll build him up and we'll take him down. A bit like the British media. What we'll do is we'll build him up here and then we'll make everyone think he's going to get with Mandy and Mandy will, you know, play along and then she'll swerve and go with Dolph Ziggler. hey, that'll be great. That'll sell tickets. But what they didn't realise is the fans really fucking enjoyed them two together. Like, so they had to swerve and sort of go with them being a proper thing. And I didn't want to talk too much about swerves that like that because they've done that a lot. WrestleMania 30, that's always a big bullshit one now where, we were always going to give Daniel Bryan the title at WrestleMania 30. That was always the plan.
There's loads of things they miss out for the build-up.
Why did you bring Batista back? If you were going to give the title to Bryan, why was Batista there? You know,
That's like this.
Do you know what? I didn't like him at the time, but as I've got to get older, I think like fair play to Batista and what a good career he had, and how he ended it in a really good way, didn't he? Well, that match was silly against Triple H. It was daft.
Oh yeah, it was an awful promo. One where he's dragging Ric Flair through the backstage of Raw, awful. But
give me what I want.
Yeah, give me what I want. That kind of shit. Nah, but the. When it was him versus Cena.
What, Drew McIntyre then? Give me what I want.
Give us what I want.
What I want from you.
But over Cena, I watched SmackDown with Batista at the time because it was, I preferred it. I had him, Rey Mysterio, Eddie Guerrero for a bit. It was a good show with Batista as a champion, I thought. And he was a good champion. He looked the part. He was one of the people that brought me back in like 2002, 2003.
Yeah, he had like, good main event matches actually as well, didn't he?
Oh, too right he did, yeah. You know, him and Booker T, although they fell out backstage, they had a good match at SummerSlam.
Did Booker T batter him?
Yeah, they had a fight backstage, yeah.
That's right. Like, you wouldn't think that, would you? Because Batista's like had poor fighting matches, hasn't he?
Well, yeah, but
I wouldn't say he was any good at him, but he won one.
Booker T's been in prison,
He's quite a late bloomer as well, wasn't he, Batista? He didn't come into WWE until like early.
Yeah, 30s. he made his debut at like 32 or something, didn't he?
Yeah. The Leviathan. Fucking hell, that's a Vince word if ever I've heard one.
The Leviathan, the prototype.
Here's another Vince word, the Mastodon. Have you ever heard anybody ever say that word and not say the man called Vader?
The band Mastodon have an album called Leviathan. It's even an album of a tune. It's definitely a song.
Okay, now that's well funny. Is there any? Do you think of any propaganda instances outside of the WWE?
I think
you say that at Wembley. The Wembley attendance thing is.
The AEW Wembley attendance, yeah.
We'll never know because of stupid tribalism. Tony Khan getting giddy.
Yeah. Go on now, what were you going to say?
I think in terms of WCW, they pretty much put it all out there, didn't they?
Pretty much. I mean.
There was nothing like. There was no grey areas with them by the time Russo would come along.
Not really. I mean, they did shit like give away Vince's Raw's results live on telly, you know. So, like, that was their sort of propaganda at the time. Like, you know, I don't think there was ever any bullshit that's carried over from them.
Yeah, there is one. Yes, there is one. There's a big one.
Go on.
What's Dave Meltzer's paper called that he writes?
Observer.
Here it is. Here's one. WCW. Observe this. Hulk Hogan when he. When the Macho Man's injury.
Yeah, and he's not injured, and he actually was. And fuck yeah.
Observe this, brother.
I tell you what, another one though as well. The way they present wrestling, like. Saturday night's main event, the first few Saturday night's main events were edited and cut together by NBC to sort of make it feel like how they wanted it to be presented. And then WWE took that and then presented the rest of their TV shows like that. And now a lot of people present TV like WWE does. A lot of people do the invisible cameraman backstage. AEW, however, has sort of got around that by saying, like, oh, there's a cameraman here or having a presenter there, you know, to interview him. So they don't have the invisible cameraman. But a lot of other people, Indie Feds do it a lot. And you're like, why are you like Shikara would do it and stuff like that. It just didn't make sense. But a lot of people present their show like WWE does. And I think a lot of people could, you know, and when something's different, like TNA's six-sided ring, it's sort of
Lucha Underground. Lucha Underground, I thought, was pretty cool when it first started. It was different.
Yeah, it was totally different the way they did things. And but I don't think that ever got sort of shit on by WWE. But if someone ever got like presented as a bit different for what they were doing, he got shit on, I think, by them. Is what I'm trying to say there. But yeah. I'm trying to think of some other examples now. I can't really think of any, but
I know what I want.
Is this just now descending into impressions?
Just the Drew McIntyre Mad Minute.
Drew McIntyre and Jesse Ventura doing commentary. Let me tell you something, McIntyre.
Is the thing here, has he signed a new deal, McIntyre?
He's injured at the moment. He's out of King of the Ring.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Yeah. But apparently, I think he has. I think McIntyre has, but Kevin Owens hasn't yet.
Kev's got 9 months left. He came out and said that the other day.
Yeah. Yeah.
Seth and Becky have re-signed for massive money. I can't see McIntyre going anywhere with what he's got going on at the minute.
No.
Isn't he married to a wrestler?
He was married to that Tiffany for a bit, but then they're divorced now, I think.
Yeah. Oh, right.
Yeah. They were only married to each other for like a year, tops. She was in TNA for a bit, wasn't she?
When he said that Sheamus is at eating burger after burger after burger.
That was a good line. I had to give it to
you. You could tell that Sheamus was like, they've got dead good mates, aren't they? You could tell Sheamus didn't know he was going to say it, couldn't you? He was pissing his sides, wasn't he, Sheamus?
That's the good thing about, I suppose, this new era that we're in. Scripted promos are gone, so stuff like that can't.
He's got a couple of times, Sheamus has, hasn't he? He's corpsed a couple of times.
Oh, yeah, Sheamus. Yeah, since he's come back.
Santino Morello made him laugh, didn't he?
Oh, yeah.
There was that, I think it was just before, there was when Punk came out and cut that promo in the ring, and there was a bit of blue language, and McIntyre's like, PG-13, brother.
PG-13.
I can do it, cunt and shit and fuck if I like.
Yeah, okay, I like the...
He needs to get pish in a promo, doesn't he?
Pish. That says Pash.
CM Punk, more like CM Pash.
Okay, really. I did like the other day, I watched Backlash. I did like the crowd, the French crowd, just taking over that. And just like making the camera rattle. I've not seen that since like Austin, the days of Austin. You
kept singing like a funny song, didn't they, whenever the word phenomenal was said?
Yeah, do you know? Because There's a French song at the moment, it's sort of big in the French charts, and like the chorus is like, c'est la vie, c'est la vie, phenomenal.
It was funny how the wrestlers didn't have a clue what were going on with it. I bet, if you was in on that, that'd be fucking well good.
AJ Styles is stood there like going, what is happening here right now?
Did you hear him chanting, you suck, in the French accents?
They all sounded like Brummies to me.
It took me ages to realise what they were shouting.
It was all like, you suck, you suck, you suck, you suck. They're like Scousers or Brummies almost. It was bizarre.
How good would a proper Scouse faction be in wrestling? Can have like dads and lads, right? And the dads have perms and moustaches and shell suits, and the lads have turkey teeth and like turkey haircuts.
The turkey fringe, the phoning.
come on, lad, saying lad all the time.
One of them grizzled young veterans has got to go and get turkey teeth and a fake tan.
Yeah.
And come back.
Absolutely.
In it. Fuck
it. Look at these lads.
Tony Khan.
tell you what, mate. I've got the proper CCTV footage from Wembley.
Just act like a Scouse Daddy Magic. Like a Daddy Magic looks like he's just always had a bump, doesn't he? You know, it's as if he goes, go, and he's boof, and you're on.
I like that. How's it going, mate? All right. Oh, all right. Hey, yeah.
Like, how he pulls faces at the cameras. Going,
fucking hell.
It's been dead weird AEW lately, hasn't it? It's been like Dynamite has been followed by Rampage and Collision and all sorts of weird bollocks, hasn't it? Well, after this week's Dynamite was Rampage, weren't there?
Yeah.
And it went to, as it changed over, it went to, I don't know if you've seen it, went to Daddy Magic and Tony Schiavone, and they were just carrying Kenny off, and Daddy Magic said dead straight face. You could see directly behind him people like pissed up having fun. Yeah. And he went, there's kids crying behind me, guys. Straight faced, right? And how Schiavone did not crack up, I do not know.
How quiet were that crowd during Rampage, by the way?
Yeah, they weren't very good, were they?
They weren't the best.
It was great. It was a good episode. Oh, it's been great,
the match, Rocky Romero and...
He's good, isn't he?
He's brilliant.
Absolutely. He's sneaky. I like it. I like how they say that he's got sneaky style. It makes me... I watch the match. I'm intrigued by his matches now, like.
He has a good career in Japan.
You know, I'm surprised I didn't fucking have Shinsuke Nakamura doing that in WWE.
Sneaky style.
Yeah.
Oh, God, no. Don't give a Japanese phrase like that to say on TV like that. It won't mean. Especially Shinsuke. He can't talk English at the best of times.
Didn't they have someone make a joke and the crowd started chanting, that was racist? And it was someone who said something to Shinsuke, and it was a written line, and he didn't want to say it.
I can't remember.
It was a piss take of how we said a Japanese word, like, you know. Crowd got on in it, chanting that was racist, and it was like, fucking hell.
Right, well, on that note, folks, we're going to end this episode about the brain.
on racism.
Racism. On that note, folks, we're going to. What do you want to talk about next month, Mr. Niall? Have you got any?
La Femme Nikita
coming up next, folks.
I'm going to start doing that next month. I'm going to do like a whole synopsis of La Femme Nikita. Next month.
Yeah.
Haven't you been going a year, guys, soon?
We've been going for a year.
Are you going to have some sort of celebration?
I think we should. I think we should have a celebratory quiz. What about that?
Oh, yes.
I think we'll get everybody back and we'll have a bit of a quiz and I'll get some specialist subjects going again. We can have another Raw Rumble Jenga and mid-season quiz.
Maybe not a music round this time.
No, there'll be no music round this one.
I hope I don't set this pad down with me, because if Emma picks it up, she'll see, and it just says on one of the pages, massive writing, bomb threat. And then underneath it says, dogs, arrow, Russo.
I would take you down, sir. Martin, are you all right?
Yeah. I'd burn that sheet of paper, Val. But yeah, so sweet. So yeah, next month we'll have a quiz. We'll get everyone back. We'll get Mr. Battelle back. We'll get Mr. Ass back. Yeah, we'll get Big Tasty Dicky, and Dirty Money. Try Big Vitamin J. See if he can come back as well. Yeah, right. Sound. I'll start getting some questions together for that. Then
we'll get Big Tasty to do a Geordie impression as well.
Yeah, see if you can do it.
I really want to hear it.
See if
Cut a promo in Geordie.
Excellent. Right. To play us out, as always, it's Little Tommy N's theme tune. The Van der Valk theme. See you, everybody. See you later, folks. Have a nice month, and we'll see you next month for a quiz. See you later. Bye.
Bye.